Hello, and welcome back to Stacktastic! Yes, the show returns, now living here on my main Beyond the Trailer channel. It's going to take you into the world of comic books, which to many of you seems mysterious, but the sad truth is that it's actually just neglected. And we're going to try and shine more of a light on it. Now, what we're going to do here is it's going to have a little bit more of a business angle to it, because this is Beyond the Trailer, so we're going to talk about not just what I recommend that you read, but also what everyone's reading. What's popular? What are the top 10 selling comics of the month? I don't believe it factors in digital sales, and they should get on that, especially as I think that's where everyone's going. But if Disney and Warner Brothers won't use the current comic book renaissance in movies and TV to push the original medium, which is just so wonderful, it is such a great form of entertainment. I really, you know, part of this is because you guys wanted me to bring this show back, but part of it is because I don't want to see comics die out, or as I often say, become just promotional pamphlets for the movies and TV. Then I'm going to try and see what I can do. And you too, by spreading the word. Now down below, because we have so much to discuss, there's not only chapter times, but also links so that you can buy these comics digitally. Yes, I have gone digital. I read all my comics digitally. I know that some of you will find that inconceivable and also not cool, because a lot of comic book stores, unfortunately, are going out of business. I have mixed feelings about that. I used to love going to the comic book store, but I feel comic book stores have not evolved. You know the saying, evolve or die, and you can see that in action right now with comic book stores. I don't think they're working hard enough to tap into the movies to make it a somewhat more mainstream experience for those of you who are like, should I read comics? I don't think it's very welcoming to that group. And also, I got pretty tired. The last day that I was in a comic book store, some of you might remember this story, I was very frustrated trying to push past a bunch of people who were just reading comics for free and weren't actually making a purchase. And then I would always get a comic book a couple of issues in to the pile of them, because I didn't want a comic that somebody else had already read. And then I pulled one out from the back, and lo and behold, it had a footprint on the front of it because someone had stepped on it and put it back on the shelf. And I was like, you know what? I'm going to go digital. And I recommend that you go digital. At the end of the day, it will make you read more comics, and that's our goal. All right, so we're going to start out with the top 10 comics for February 2018. And I would like to know down below if you're reading any of these yourself, and if so, why, and if not, why not? Now, the top selling comic book for the month, I'm not reading, and that's Dark Knights Rising, The Wild Hunt, which is part of Scott Snyder's DC Metal. Now, Scott Snyder really did a lot to just completely rehaul DC Comics. He is like, for the most part, it was like the New 52 and then Rebirth. But when it comes to talent that really energized the comic book company, it's really, you know, Scott Snyder alone. I think they're hoping that maybe Brian Michael Bendis, who they've just brought over, can be another Scott Snyder. Now, I've never really taken to his work, but I have a tremendous amount of respect for how popular he is with a certain group of readers. Now, the reason I'm not a fan is that I don't think that his work stands on its own. I think it's too meta. It requires an intense knowledge of tons of other obscure storylines. It's like Grant Morrison's worst qualities, right? But without, I feel like the emotional components, it's very cold. His writing's very cold. I would almost say it's as if DC hired the Riddler to write comics. I think that's how it comes across to me. And I, whatever the Riddler says, oh, riddle me this, I'm like, I don't even want to try, okay? And that's often how I feel about Scott Snyder's work. But I'm very excited about his Justice League. Now he's created like X-Men type teams of different rosters. Also, I'll certainly be checking that out. And I did start DC Metal, but even with just the first issue, I was like, I can't do this. But I'm curious, for those of you who are reading it, what do you think? And it is the top selling comic of the month. So he's doing something right. All right, so the second comic of the month I did buy, but I did not enjoy it, and that's X-Men Red. Now, speaking of X-Men teams, they had the classic blue and gold teams return, and then they decided to add another one led by Jean Grey. And I think the reason this comic sold so well is the curiosity factor, and I'll be curious to see, speaking of curiosity, how it goes with the upcoming issues, because if any of you read it, and I'd be curious to what your reaction was, I thought it was a major letdown. Now, the premise is that adult Jean Grey is back. They had a whole Resurrection of Jean Grey storyline, which was really horrible. Actually, though, we're going to talk about that writer because they totally made up for it with another comic I'm going to recommend. But she came back and they put her in a look that's kind of similar. It's trying to pull on the old nostalgia heartstrings here to the look she wore in the animated series and also the heyday of the X-Men comics. So she's leading up a team, and it's just a mess. I think all the X-Men comics are absolutely unreadable, and this is sadly no exception. They were so good. Speaking of Grant Morrison, when he wrote the title, the main title, I even thought with Brian Michael Bendis, even though he undid a lot of what was done before, I still liked what he did. I thought it was pretty good. But now they're just awful. I actually don't read any X-Men comics on a regular basis, which is crazy. I do read Rogue and Gambit, actually. Considering that I started out as a Batman X-Men fan. Those are my two go-to groups, and I just cannot pick up X-Men comics right now. They just got a new editor. I hope that he turns things around. All right, now both 3 and 4 goes to Tom King's Batman, which comes out twice a month. That's why I can have two spots on this list. Now, Tom King rose to being a really hot comic book writer off of his Vision miniseries over at Marvel, which was indeed spectacular. It has nothing to do with the movies, but it's so good, and it's finite because it was only a limited run. I highly recommend you pick up this trade. You cannot get a better comic book than this. So DC was obviously impressed, hired him away. It wasn't as big a scandal because, he's pretty new to the game, so he wasn't like Mr. Marvel like Brian Michael Bendis was. And also, they hired him to do Mr. Miracle, which is very similar to Vision. In fact, I'm going to recommend an issue of Mr. Miracle today. But I think he's also revealed himself in his move to DC to be a one-trick pony. Vision's very similar to Mr. Miracle, and his Batman stuff is also it's cut from the same cloth, even though I don't think it fits with Batman, unfortunately. I think Tom King does have some good ideas, though, and I think he is shaking up the status quo. He's having Batman and Catwoman get married. And so I still read this title, even though I think it's a little bit hit or miss. Now, for instance, the issue number 40 is the second half of a great Wonder Woman story. It's a two-parter. I highly recommend you check it out. It's really interesting, and it puts those two characters in such an interesting situation, both professionally and personally. I really liked it. But then as for 41, it's the beginning of a very weak Poison Ivy storyline. I get so excited whenever Poison Ivy, and I think Gotham's doing a pretty good job with her this season, and even they have struggled to get her just right, though. But whenever Poison Ivy shows up, I'm always like, oh, I hope they get her right this time, and I'm always so sadly disappointed. She's a very tough character to do, and she's unfortunately caught a little bit in the shadow of Harley Quinn, these days. But someone will get, the Batman the Animated Series knew what they were doing with her, and I have hope that someday someone will get Poison Ivy right yet again. All right, so the number 5 is The Walking Dead. I don't read this comic. I don't watch the show. I'm not a zombie fan. But you can see it continues to be the most popular non-Marvel DC title out there. As the show continues to be the most popular non-DC Marvel comic book property out there. So that's amazing. Now, just if you're wondering, the other big sellers that aren't from DC and Marvel right now are the Reconnaissance, the bringing back Kick-Ass and Hit-Girl, although I think with mixed results, that's Mark Miller. But then also Saga, so good. All Image, by the way. If you're looking for titles when they come out each month, the three publishers that you should look at are Marvel, DC, but then also Image. See what they're releasing. They're very, very solid. So Saga, by the way, is probably the best comic book that's out right now. And you should totally be reading it. It's so amazing. And it's accessible to anyone. All right, so the number 6, speaking of Batman, Batman White Knight number 5. This is such a good miniseries. It's only an 8-issue limited series. It's so sad, but I suspect they're going to either have him do a second limited series or give him an ongoing, because not only is it good, but it's selling well. So this is from Sean Murphy. It's the best thing he's ever done. He's always himself been hit or miss, but I think what really helps him here is that he's clearly coming from a place of being a fan of Batman the Animated Series, and that just permeates this entire run. It's really interesting. It's an Elseworlds story about how the Joker becomes reformed. He becomes Jack Napier, and he takes on Batman through the system. Their roles are almost reversed in a way, and it's really good. They bring in all the villains, all the heroes, and I think Sean Murphy has some really interesting ideas of how to take a second look at Batman the Animated Series. And Sean Murphy, by the way, is a talent that was brought to DC by Scott Snyder. He was kind of like putting around in comics on the fringe. Scott Snyder brought him in to do a story with American Vampire. That's a pretty good series, but it ended up not going anywhere. And it lost Scott Snyder's interest, unfortunately. But that's how Sean Murphy got in the door to the upper leagues of comics. And this is, it's all been leading to this. And it was all worth it. All the crap that I read from him, like the Tokyo thing that he did. And I was like, this sure is pretty, but it's really badly written. It was all worth it to get to here. I can't recommend this comic book miniseries enough. The number 7 is Peter Parker, Spectacular Spider-Man. This is one of those milestone issues. Number 300. But I thought the story itself was pretty weak. It does have a nice Black Cat backup story, though, with art by Goran Parlov, who's a fabulous artist. He doesn't work too much, but I discovered him with a Nick Fury miniseries. He's really, really good. And he's a good match with Black Cat. You know, he's like a film noir kind of artist, right? And they've been teasing a Black Cat upgrade in the comics for some time now, turning her into like the new Kingpin. But let's see if it actually ever happens and if they can deliver on the promise of said upgrade. So far, I'm not seeing it. So far, I think Black Cat is just, you know, a lot of talk and very little action, quite frankly. And I think someone should call her on it. And number 8, a Star Wars comic. You know, I have to say, they moved, you know, when Disney purchased Lucasfilm, they moved the Star Wars comics from Dark Horse to Marvel. Sucked for Dark Horse. But they sell pretty well. I don't read them. But this, you know, I don't think they advertise them very well because I'm a big fan of Kieran Gillen's writing, and he's writing this current arc, and it has Luke, Leia, and Han in it. So, you know, I would maybe consider looking at it. I think that the Star Wars stories are a little tough to get into because there's so much backstory and lore to you have to know to really appreciate it. And also, when I started to read the Star Wars comics when they first started at Marvel, I don't know how you guys felt, but I felt that they were holding back a little bit. Like, there was a little too much meddling from, you know, the people who make the movies and the TV shows, and they couldn't really just tell these great, interesting stories. I guess to me, these so far have screamed promotional pamphlet. And so I hope it's better, but it's you know, it's selling, so you can't fault Marvel for what's working. Don't, if it ain't broke, don't fix it. Now, number 9 was Infinity Countdown Prime. You know, they have a little movie called Infinity War coming out, so Marvel Comics is trying to capitalize on that by telling their own Infinity Stone and Infinity Gauntlet story. Now, I'm not a fan of this. I think it's a little too convoluted. There's a big reveal at the end of the issue, and I was like, meh. But I have to say, I did get a kick out of Wolverine using the Space Stone in a way only that Wolverine would, in a real nonchalant kind of way. I thought that worked. And I also liked his interaction with Loki, who is currently the Sorcerer Supreme. I thought that was very good. I think the comics get Loki much better than the movies have. And it's a shame, because Tom Hiddleston's a good Loki, and there's good material for him. They're just not putting the two together. So I liked the first half of this comic, but then I thought it got a little bit too, you know, sometimes they just, like, you know, have everything but including the kitchen sink to try and get people excited about a story, and I don't like that. I like things that are a little more organic. I think you have to earn it. I'm not big for the shock and awe unless you've earned it. I don't like starting, I guess, with shock and awe so much. All right, so the number 10, the 10th best-selling issue for the month, is Amazing Spider-Man number 795. And speaking of Loki, he's here too. Another great interaction with Spider-Man, and I thought Loki's Loki's true motives here, I thought, were very interesting, and the comic does a good job masking them. I thought it was a good reveal toward the end. And also, Dan Slott, he's winding up his time on Spider-Man. It's one of the most iconic runs in comic book history. Not only because it's so long, but because, in my opinion, I think a lot of other people's, it's so good. I think Dan Slott did a great job constantly reinventing the character, keeping him fresh. I'll always love Superior Spider-Man, what he did with Otto Octavius taking over Peter Parker's body and maybe doing a little bit of a better job with it. But everything that he did with Peter Parker Industries, just everything. And I'm going to be sad to see him go. And I don't know who, it's going to be really hard for someone to pick up where he left off. And I don't know how Dan Slott's going to do with the Iron Man titles. I don't know if he's a good choice for that. We'll have to see. But he is one of the best Spider-Man writers of all time. And I'm going to be indeed sad to see him go. If you're looking for something to read, you know, if you want to go back and pick up old comics, start with where Dan Slott started on Spider-Man and you will have a fabulous run. It's so good! All right, now let's go to my recommendations. Because we did the top 10 list for the month will be every other episode. So when I don't do the top 10 selling comics, I'll recommend more. But because we just did the top 10, I'm going to recommend 5 comics today. All right, so the number 1 is the one I'm the most excited about because it was such a pleasant surprise. I did not expect this to be so good. I bought it on a whim. Because I think comics are in a little bit of a rough state right now, I'll look at my picks for the week and I'll be like, that's not a lot of comics. I have hardly anything to read. So I'll go and maybe take a chance on something I normally wouldn't. And so I decided to pick up Tales of Suspense, which features Hawkeye and the Winter Soldier in a story called Red Ledger, and they're hunting down Black Widow, who is supposed to have been killed by Hydra Cap, long story, not a good one either. But, you know, Hawkeye is convinced that she's still alive because there's some evidence of it, and he and Winter Soldier team up to go and see if that's the case. So I looked at a couple of, you know, they'll let you see the first three or four pages of a comic on Comixology, and I thought the artwork by Travel Foreman was very good. It reminded me actually of Jay Lee, who did, I think, some of his most famous recent work was on the Before Watchmen Ozymandias series, which is actually very good. And so I was like, this looks pretty, I'll buy it. And I'm so happy I did. It's amazing. I bought all four issues that are already out. There's one more to go in the story, and I read them all in one sitting. They're excellent. And Matthew Rosenberg, who wrote The Resurrection of Jean Grey, which I thought was absolutely horrible, so bad, is so good here. It's amazing. The voices that he so perfectly captures the voice of both Hawkeye and Winter Soldier, and they're so different, and they take turns narrating the story. It's a hoot. It's a good mystery. It's exciting. It's very funny, and I think it's very true to character. I can't recommend it highly enough. So good. All right, so that's my first recommendation. My second is The Mighty Thor. Now, the current arc is the death of the Mighty Thor. That's right. Lady Thor didn't sell enough comics. Not popular with the masses, you know, that infamous situation where retailers went to Marvel editorial and said, you're too SJW, no one's buying the comics. You gotta change it up. So that's why they're getting everybody, to the original versions of the characters. So Lady Thor's gotta go. And this is that story. And it's a shame that the focus has been Thor's not a lady, because I think they told a really good story here. And they made it clear the whole time that she was only renting Mjolnir, Jane Foster, right? That this wasn't a long-term, this wasn't going to be the new status quo. And I think, and that plays up in the story. And I think it's turned into, and Jason Aaron, by the way, his Thor run has also been really, really strong. One of you recommended recently to do the God Hunter, you know, killing the gods story for a Thor movie. So it was like one of Jason Aaron's first Thor stories. So good. Really, it's excellent stuff. But what I think that he's ended up exploring here with Lady Thor, Jane Foster, is the sacrifices that it takes to be a hero and the missed opportunities in life. Like, it's so sophisticated to see Jane Foster, you know, her romance with Thor didn't work out. She's basically alone. She has cancer. And just what has become of her. And I think it's so sophisticated because, you don't know what's going to happen to you. And to see how Jane Foster ended up and her just staring in the face of that boldly, unblinking, with maybe some regret, but, you know, for the most part, owning it, I think it's a fabulous story. And she's going to, you know, the next issue is the last of this, and I think the last of Lady Thor as a whole, so you should make sure you're there. And she better freaking die, by the way. She can come back later, but, you know, I think it's important that's the end of this story. And you're not going to want to miss it. It's excellent. And by the way, shout out to the artist, Russell Donnerman. He was the artist on my comic book, Superbia. He's very, very talented, very cinematic. Right now, the third, speaking of the cinema, the third thing that I want to recommend today, the third comic is Mr. Miracle number 7. Now, you can read all the Mr. Miracle comics. They're very good. This, again, is Tom King. And, you know, you might want to get into the New Gods because Ava DuVernay, of course, is set to make that movie. We'll see if it ever happens, but if you want to be prepared, this is a good place to start. But this one is a standalone issue, pretty much. So if you want to just dabble in the New Gods and Mr. Miracle, this is the place to do it. The story is that Big Barda is giving birth to their child, her child with Scott Free, a.k.a. Mr. Miracle. And the female Furies, who she used to fight with on Apocalypse, they show up to sit in the waiting room like the crazy relatives that they are, so to speak. And that's this is overall a perfect example of what Tom King does so well. And that's mix the absurd with the ordinary. It's like, I don't know, it's almost like comic book Seinfeld. It's really, really good. And this is a great standalone issue. Love it so much. All right, so number 4 is the new incarnation of Runaways. That's right, this title is back yet again. They tried to bring it back once before without its creator, Brian K. Vaughan, and it didn't work out so well. But this new writer, Rainbow Rowell, we'll talk about her in just a moment, and the artist, but they've really recaptured the original magic. But the first thing I want to touch on is that some of you might be watching Runaways on Hulu. I tried to watch it. I thought it was okay. But you might be wondering why I'm not more into it. And I think not only is it the show itself, but the fact that the story is so far ahead of where it started at this point, that it's really hard to ask to go back to the beginning, right? Because I don't know about you, but as a Runaways fan, I'm so interested in what's happening to these characters now. And that's what's being explored. So Rainbow Rowell is new to comics. She's a young adult author, and I think she's doing an an excellent job. But the real star of this new version of the characters is artist Chris Anka. He's such a good artist. I actually follow him on Twitter because I'm such a fan of his artwork. And I discovered him on the Star-Lord miniseries that he recently did, which I also recommend. It's very, very good. It's, again, it's a finite story. It's just a couple of issues, so you can read that and not have to worry about catching up to too much stuff. But it's very good. Now, he's a very good artist, not only because he's very expressive. He does a good job getting across personality, and he also action. He's the full package. But speaking of packages, one of the things that he does so well as an LGBT artist is that he's particularly good at drawing sexy guys, which is unusual to see in comics. So often it's sexy women, strong, muscular guys, right? But he kind of changes it up. And I think it's a crime, by the way, that he's not the artist on Nightwing. Different publisher, he's a Marvel guy right now, but I mean, talk about stealing people from the other side. This is who DC should be trying to poach. He was born to draw Nightwing. He does a great job, though. Very, very good artist. And that's the main reason I would actually recommend both the Star-Lord miniseries, written by Chip Zdarsky, and I think Chip's hit or miss, and then also this new Runaways. All right, so then the fifth comic that I'm going to recommend is only for a few pages. Now, this is East of West. This is number 36 specifically. I've been reading this since number one. And you might be like, why would I jump in on issue 36? Won't it be hard to follow? I've been reading it since the beginning and I still can't follow it. This thing's a mess, but it's a beautiful mess. And I have to say, almost every time I read it, it's worth my time for a really cool visual or story element. And this time, for number 36, it features the most sophisticated discussion that I've ever seen of the aftermath of a rebellion and the realities of that. It's amazing! Again, worth it for just these few pages alone. What the characters say, the truth of it, the honest truth, and also how it's depicted visually. So powerful. I read these few pages and I was like, wow, this is a reason alone to make this into a TV series. It needs serious reworking, but you know, it's this kind of sophisticated storytelling is why indie comics continue to thrive. And I'm curious, is anyone else reading East of West? And what do you think of it? Why have you stuck with it, even though sometimes you wonder, why would you? I mean, I question all the time if I should buy it, but again, I've never regretted a purchase of this comic. All right, so thanks for watching the new Stacktastic with me. I'm excited to hear your thoughts down below about the comics we've discussed today. And also let me know if there's any comic you'd like me to cover in a future episode and any comic book related questions that you might have that you'd like to discuss. Again, you know, you guys wanted this show back, so I really want to know what you would like to see in it. And I will do what I can to deliver that. All right, thanks so much for tuning in. And of course, as always, you can check out some more episodes right now.